Welcome to the Revelation Code. I'm your host, Suzanne, and I want you to stay with us over the next 30 minutes for an in-depth look into the world of prophecy and how it affects your life today. Whether you believe in prophecy or not, the prophetic words in the Bible are coming true daily. Wars and rumors of wars, nations rising up, and the rise of famine and sickness all point to the end of time the Bible talks about. How close are we to the end of days, and what will happen in our lifetime? Stay tuned, you're about to find out. Today on the Revelation Code.
One that cometh from Bozrah with his garments dipped in blood. Jesus in Revelation 19 rides on a white horse, and his garments are what? Dipped in blood. So Revelation 19, when Jesus comes back on that white horse to the earth, is the parallel in Isaiah 63, and it tells you in Isaiah 63 what it doesn't tell you in Revelation 19, and it goes something like this. Kings, and that's going to be the 10 kings of prophecy, all right? And everybody preached that. When Greece came in, everybody was going crazy. This is it, this is it. Well, then an 11th nation joined, then a 12th nation joined, then the 13th nation, 14th nation, 15th nation, and now there's over 20 nations connected, some loosely to the EU. And the last time I counted, there's only 10 toes on that foot. Woohoo! Y'all still here? So what you gonna do with all those other nations? Here's what happens. The EU will have a breakup. Now, Greece is in such debt, and the reason they're in debt, anybody want me to explain Greece debt to you, raise your hand. If you don't understand, I'll tell you. What happened is that in Greece, you can basically retire when you're 55 if you work a government job. Then they give you basically at retirement the same amount of pay you were getting while you're working. Okay, that works great when you got huge tourism, plenty of tax money, and a lot of money to go around. But when the tax money starts ceasing and the economy starts dropping and you go into recession, you cannot pay the bills from the contracts of all the union people. See, now whether you know this or not, that's what's happening in California. The reason California has four cities going on five that are on the verge of bankruptcy, and look, I'm fine with people making what they want to make if you got the money to pay it and you don't have to rob everybody else to get the money. But see, what's happened is the economic slump, they cannot pay the money. The tax money is not coming in. The revenue's not coming in. So now you got a city saying, we owe people $500 million, and we're in debt $900 million, and we ain't got the money, so something's got to give somewhere. Now, that's the way it is in some of our cities right now. That's what's happened in Greece. That's what's happened in Italy. That's what's happened in Portugal. That's what's happened in Spain. And those nations I named you are EU nations. And there is a real shakeup. Now, we've not even seen it yet. They're just bailing them out right now. But if there's not a recovery or an increase of income, we've not seen. Now, what does the Bible say about the kingdom? It shall be partly broken and partly strong. Is anybody catching the revelation I'm giving you right here? So I go to Spain. I fly into Spain this summer, and my wife and I did a Mediterranean cruise. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I go to Italy, and I did not know this, but my guide in Pompeii was a professor of history. And when I found it out, I started manifesting. I went nuts. I didn't want him to tour nobody else. I wanted him to sit with me and talk to me face to face. One of the questions I asked him was social medicine, where Italy has the same kind of medicine of Obamacare. In other words, what they do in Italy is it's pretty much government-funded health care. So I said, do you like it? He said, well, it's good that it's free. So I said, you can go to the doctor anytime. He said, yeah. I said, are there delays? He just laughed. He said, depends on what you got. He said, seriously, you may have to wait for surgery 3 to 6 months. He said, it's like that all over where there's socialized medicine. Depends on your population, how many are sick, what they're going through, how many doctors are available. And I said, is it free? You know, when you say it's free, he said, it's free, but it ain't free. He said, when they sold it to us a long time ago, we thought it was great. He said, but let me tell you, I'm a professor. Let me tell you how much of my money the government gets just to take care of health care. Out of my paycheck comes 60% of my income. And I said, are you kidding me? He says, no. He said, some people, it's as high as 80%, meaning that if you make a dollar, the Italian government gets 80% of it. And he said, really, it's turned into a mess. And he said, you all are going the same way we are. Now, the difference, you see, of comparing our healthcare system to Canada. See, Canada, I just preached up there and asked the guys, what about your healthcare? He said, well, ask the lady who's 80 years old that busted her knee the other day that I had to take to the hospital. He said she sat in the emergency room for 38 hours with a busted knee, and when the clock stopped, the doctors walked right out the door and said, sorry, ma'am, my time is up, and walked out the door, and an old woman sat 38 hours. Another member of the church busted his collarbone, sat 40 hours in a room just waiting to see a doctor. Now, here's what you've got to understand. In Canada, we are 10 times bigger than them. All right? Now, I don't know if you know this or not, but under this new health care bill, they've already done polls in the American Medical Journal that 80% of the doctors within the next 4 to 5 years are thinking about quitting. Some of them are going to already move to the Caribbean where they have a house. They're already getting permission from other countries in the islands to set up a little practice over there. And in my hometown of Cleveland, Tennessee, in the hospital, I won't name the hospital, I don't want it coming back on me because doctors don't like you to tell what they say, but in a room where it came on, and the Supreme Court case came down, a whole group of doctors in the top hospital looked at each other and said, well, I guess, guys, we're out of here now. In my hometown, they quit taking Medicare at certain hospitals for older people. So I'm telling you, we're on the verge, and it all sounds good. It's free, it's free, it's free. Yeah, it's free with 21 new taxes in it. And I'm not saying we don't need to readjust the system. We do need to readjust it. But what we need to do is drop that and go back to the drawing board and start all over again, right? Just start over again and find out what will work and what will be a balanced system. Now, that's not my hobby horse. I don't have a dog in that fight. But what I want you to understand, it's those kind of things that's causing Europe to brink, some of those EU nations to brink. Now, do you all want a real heavy revelation? No, you don't. I'm going to come off my notes and just start going to the heavy stuff. I believe personally, and let me just preface this by saying, in the Middle East, I have a lot of Muslim friends. I have a lot of Jewish friends. I have a lot of Arab Christian friends. And Robbie, who goes with me and tapes with me, knows I'm not blowing smoke. I'm telling you the truth. My Muslim friends know that I believe that the Mahdi of Islam fits the picture of what the Bible identifies as the last dictator that forms that eighth kingdom. They know that. They've heard me teach it on location. All right. Let me just take my time here and get this out because I want to make sure that we get this right and share this right. There are some teachings in Islam that no one in the West knows that I've studied that explain to me how one man could form and get 10 people, 10 kings, kingdoms to follow him and then control buying and selling. Has that ever puzzled you how one man can control buying and selling for the whole world? I'll tell you how it's done. In Islamic teaching, you cannot charge a brother Muslim interest. If you and I, if I have an Islamic bank and you come to me and you want $50,000, I cannot, by the Quran, charge you interest. What I can do is have you put up collateral. If I don't pay it back, brother, I'm just going to have to give you this huge piece of property or my business here if I can't pay it back, but I can't charge you interest. What has got the mortgage situation in America and the housing situation in the mess was when they took interest and had it low and they kept selling it out and ballooning it, come on, called an ARM. And so somebody got a loan at 3.5 or 2.5%. And then years later, they find out that it went to 6.5 and they can't pay it, so they have to give up their house. In Europe, the same thing is true. The interest of the banks is collapsing parts of Europe because people can't pay the interest back. All you have to have is an Islamic leader with a ton of money to go into Greece and say, I will bail all of you out at no interest. All you have to do is to convert to Islam. It's very simple. We have complicated the whole issue of how one man can control all the buying and selling and cause people to follow him. All you got to do is guarantee the money to them. And all these people who are unemployed, that do not have jobs, that are unable to feed their families, you tell me when you can't feed your family, what are you going to do? You will be willing to submit and capitulate, and it'll be like, what's the big deal? What's the big deal? All religions go to God. That's what everybody says anyway. And so, but by not charging interest. Now you say, Islam doesn't have that kind of money. You're just a dumb American. I'm serious. Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, Dubai. Do you know how many buildings? Dubai has a hotel that you got to pay money just to go in the lobby and look at it. Anybody see the movie Mission Impossible? Do you know the building he climbed on? That's the building in Dubai. That's the hotel. That's it. It actually exists. Dubai. Listen, Dubai. Help me here. I had a friend of mine that was over there, and he was going out to the tribes and kind of witnessing and sharing the Lord. And one of the government guys pulls up in a caravan, and he has little bags of gold coins that he hands the Bedouins. And tells them, now when you go into the city to shop, use this. Now that's point two. In the book of Daniel, it says he'll be over the treasures of gold and silver. I just wrote a book. I'm not trying to push the book because it hadn't even been printed yet, but it'll be on Manifest in 5 weeks. It's called Your Finances in the Last Day. And I do this entire prophetic chapter on gold and silver and metals. Here's what you may not understand. Recently, India paid for Iranian oil, because the oil was under a ban where you can't use dollars, $700 million in gold to Iran. They're going back to using gold. Oh, I shouldn't go there. Woo, help me, Jesus. Okay. All right. I got to be so careful, because everything you take, people take it and they ride it and they talk about it. But I'm going to go ahead and go there anyway. Let me talk to you for just a moment about gold and silver, because in Islam, Muhammad made a statement that at the end of days, that currency or the money, let me translate it this way, that the currencies of nations would not be good, and the gold and silver money would be what Islam would use at the very end of days. And in Indonesia, there's a whole organization that's trying to amass the gold and the silver to be able to produce coins. And under the Ottoman Turkish Empire, for 400 years, the Turks had gold coins. I've got some of them in a collection. And they used the gold coins as legal tender. So in Islam, what they will do eventually is take the gold coins and make the gold and silver coins, which puts them in the total economic seat, being able to lend money without interest. Can everybody see how this plays out, for especially in Europe and the Middle East, for nations to fall into that system and to be able to follow this man who is trying to do this economic control thing? All right. What I'm going to share with you, in fact, let me do this. I've got about 9 minutes left. I'm weighing on whether I should cut the tape off and just tell this crowd or not. Give me a second. Okay, let me just be careful. Let me not say too much. I'm okay if I don't. You know, the Lord told me I had a big mouth. So I got to be careful here. There is a possibility of a global currency coming, in which that currency can be used anywhere in the world. China, Russia, America, Canada, and Mexico. It's a currency that's a global currency. Every nation I have researched, their leaders are now saying, we want one currency to stabilize the world. And we will RV it at the rate we wish. And I think eventually that's coming. I don't know when, but I think it's coming. In order to make this currency work, you need to put it on a gold or silver standard. I am only going to tell you what I've heard. And this has come from a high source that I am not going to name. Okay? It's not top secret or classified. It's just something that a guy told me. In fact, it's someone in the World Bank. All right. This is the thought and the idea. When they eventually get this currency, global currency going, they want it backed by gold and silver. Allegedly, in the United States right now, there's a plan. I'm not saying they've already built them. I don't know. To build 10 treasury banks. This is not Federal Reserve Bank, treasury banks. The American citizens can then take all the gold and silver coins and certificates they have that they've got in deposit boxes and deposit them in one of the 10 major banks, okay? Then the currency will be backed by your own gold and silver. Then you will get a small interest rate for keeping your gold and silver inside that treasury bank. Now, to prove something must be up, one man last year went to Dubai and shipped in $380 million in gold. I don't even know where the guy's got it stored. But without going into detail, there's a group of men in the United States, there are 18 of them, who meet on a ship. And these 18 are basically controlling the idea of, actually, they're talking about who they're going to put in as the next president. And I could tell you who it is, but I'm not going to go there. But they're working on the presidential thing because they want to, they just have their own agendas, okay? Now, what would happen is anyone with gold, the money would be backed by gold. But this is the second story I just heard from a source who knows one of the men. The discussion, I am not telling you they're doing this now, but the discussion is that China, Russia, and India and the Middle East has so much gold that they're going to put theirs on a gold standard and America will go back to the silver standard. Now, I understand commodities. I'm not dumb. You think all I can do is preach? I can do more than that. I can buy a book for $300 worth $25,000. Come on, help me preach now, somebody. All right, now, here's the point. When gold has dropped from 1,900 an ounce to 1,500 an ounce, why didn't silver follow? If you watch commodities, silver should when gold fell $300 an ounce, silver should be back down to 10 and 12, and it's not. And all of the investors I know who invest in commodities are telling people, go get silver. It's cheaper. Go get the silver now. Hold on to it. And if we do this, if this comes through, then America's currency, whatever we use, is backed by a silver bank, right? The only way to stabilize it, and how many of you have ever heard Ron Paul talk about stuff like this? You know, Ron Paul's a genius on this stuff. And so the only way to keep a currency from collapsing is have something to back it. And we have nothing to back the dollar right now. Now, let me get off of that subject because that's a rabbit trail that I had no intention of going into. You pull this stuff out of me when I should keep my mouth shut. Let's go back very quickly to this idea of who the 10 kings are. The 10, there's only two options you have. You have the option that these 10 kings end up being 10 European nations of the EU that the Antichrist takes over. The only problem with that theory is the early fathers in Daniel tell you three of the 10 that are uprooted, and it's Egypt, Libya, and Ethiopia, and they're Muslim and Islamic, and they're not in the EU. If the Antichrist were to be a European Prince Charles, as some have suggested, then the Middle East wouldn't even be involved. It's only Europe. But when you read the Bible, this whole thing is a Middle Eastern. Come on, you understand the Mediterranean Sea is where the beast rises out of. And great to the south and the east, it's all those Islamic nations where the shakeup's taking place. But if the Antichrist were Muslim, his interest would be into controlling, you ready? All of the places being shaken up by the Arab Spring. Because here's what happens in the Arab world. My Arab friends have told me, they said, we're wild people. We're sons of Ishmael. God said Ishmael would be a wild ass. That's in your King James Bible, by the way. For you that are going to give me a look like, why did he say that in the pulpit? It's King James, woo! Okay? They said, we're wild by nature. And said, we have to have a strong leader to get us in subjection when we get out of line. And that's why these men over the years have ruled for 20, 30, and 40 years. Because when their own people get out of line, they just go crazy after them. And then yes, sir, yes, sir, yes, sir. Okay? Now, having said that, I want you to understand something. Oh, Lord, where do we go from here? That in these nations that are shaken up, it leaves a void. Look at Egypt. They had no leadership for a year. And then they had to have a vote, and everybody's fussing over who really won. Libya, you don't hear a lot about it because it's an oil state. And they have oil money, which Egypt doesn't have. But what I'm saying is, it's like Syria. Y'all tell me, who's going to take over Syria now? Who's going to take over? You got Hezbollah in Lebanon that wants to come in, and you've got the Iranians who have been under giving weapons to Assad. If Iran comes in there, there's a real mess about to happen. So it leaves a void. Here's my point. With the shakeup going on, it's the early stages of the alignment of nations for this empire of Bible prophecy. Never in my lifetime, never, I'm telling you before the Lord, never did I dream that I would be here and stand here and show you that Egypt and Libya and Ethiopia are now in the hands of individuals who could submit to a man called the Antichrist. I would 3 years ago have never seen this. Folks, listen to me. Jesus is coming. So here's what I want to ask you. Amen. Amen. The Messiah's coming. But here's what I want to ask you. What counts from now to the moment of the time of the end? What's going to count? Here's what's going to count. Number one, occupy till I come. I want to say a word to all of you. I'm building a $16 million building, a gathering place for the last day move of God. You know why? Because I am not going to sit around as a 53-year-old man and say, Jesus has come and let me not do nothing. And then 5 years from now, me still be sitting there saying, I wish I would have done something. My grandfather hoped he would come in his day. My father hoped he would come in his day. He did not. And I've learned a lesson. Live like he could come now. But plan like he won't come in your lifetime. If you'll live, whoo, hallelujah, like he could come today, you'll always clean your heart and make sure your heart's right before you go to bed at night. But if you will plan in the future, you'll not be disappointed because you didn't fulfill God's word. So I'm going to keep planting and keep building and keep sowing my offerings and keep reaching people. And when the trumpet sounds, I'm going up. And 7 years later, I'll come back and take that property over and keep on using it for God in the name of Jesus. And then in Cleveland, Tennessee, every old deadhead that would never come out and hear me preach that survives the tribulation, I'm going to say, I'm preaching and you got to get out here because God's going to whip your hide if you don't. Let's go. And they're going to have to drag out of bed and come on out to the... Number one is occupy till he comes. Number two, it is important that even though you don't think you're winning your family to the Lord, keep planting seed. Plant seed. Don't quit planting a tape, a book, a video, a word. You will never know when they're going to flip it in. And I'll share this story with you. A woman called me from New York. She says, my husband is one of the lawyers for the NFL football players. And I'm not going to give you his name because he's a Jewish man. And said I'm Catholic. I've raised my girls in the Catholic Church. He's always been supportive of me. But he don't want nothing to do with Jesus. He's a great husband. Wants nothing to do with Jesus. And I've tried for 15 years to win him to the Lord. And nothing worked. Well, at that time, it was about 13 years when she's talking about this. So she says, a couple years back, you were preaching in Israel on the war of Gog and Magog. I said, honey, get in here quick. There's going to be a war in Israel. He runs in and said, what is it? She said, listen to this man. There's a war coming. He plopped down in the seat and just looked at you. Said he wouldn't even look at Christian TV. I didn't tell him it was a Christian TV. He said, you were from Israel talking about Gog and Magog, and over here's where the battle. He said, well, that's really interesting. A part two coming up next week. He said, well, I don't usually listen to guys like this, but let me hear that part two when it comes. So he listened to part two. She said, for 2 years, every time you came from Israel with the program, he listened. It took 2 years. She calls me and says, he came to me the other day. He said, you cannot tell my friends what I'm about to tell you, because it'll just be a nothing but harassment for me. But he said, the other day I finally made up my mind after, you know, intellectually examining scripture and looking at things, that your Jesus is the Messiah. And I went ahead and accepted him. Isn't that great? What is going to count is winning people to the Lord. Two things. Do God's will and win as many people as you can. And I can't help but conclude with a story. I can't help. My time on my CD is up, but maybe you'll keep the DVD going for people that may be interested in this. I was in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, and found out that the son of this man lives in Louisiana. I'd heard the story for years. And a man said to me, he said, no, it's this guy right over here. It happened to him and his dad. This man was, this young man's father was a missionary who had spent his entire life on the mission fields. Away from America, away from the comforts of America to win people to the Lord. Many years ago, they took a boat. This is a long time back, but they took a boat from and back, and they rowed a nice boat, large ship, back to the United States, to the port. When they got to the port, the captain came on, and there was a real famous American who was on the boat. And the captain said, ladies and gentlemen, if you look over the deck, you'll see that there's a large crowd of photographers and reporters waiting for so-and-so who was on our ship to exit. And we're going to let them exit first, then clear the dock, and then the others can come. So they stood there and watched, and man, people screaming, photographers, and just going crazy. And they're just up at the deck watching. Well, the crowd begins to disperse as the person goes away, and then the other people are off. And they were some of the last ones off because he was a real old man. So they got up from where they were sitting, went out, and the son looked at his dad and said, I just can't believe this. He said, Dad, I am very angry right now. He said, son, what's upset you? He said, here this person is, they're just a movie star. You're a missionary. You gave your life for the gospel. You had people that supported you for years. Now you're coming back home. And where are the people? Why isn't there a church here? Why isn't there preachers here? Why isn't there somebody here thanking you for what you did now that you've come home? And the old man, he's kind of limped over walking. He just poked him and said, son, I ain't home yet. Hallelujah. Now we're going home, but we're not home yet. Whatever we do for Christ, we really need to pick up the pace, get serious, and do it.
Receive today's sermon on DVD or CD, or become a monthly partner. And receive each sermon this season on CD, DVD, plus find out more on our Facebook page. And stay up to date with what's happening in prophecy. Join me next week as we look further into unlocking the Revelation code.